Good morning. For our call to worship this morning, I'd like to read from Psalm 71, verses 1 through 3. It says, "In thee, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be ashamed. In thy righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline thine ear to me and save me. Be thou to me a rock of habitation, to which I may continually come. For thou hast given commandment to save me. For thou art my rock and my fortress." We would like to welcome you to the Alburnett Christian Church this morning. Some announcements that we'd like to highlight. Youth group will meet at 6 o'clock on Wednesday. It's good to have Bill and Pam back with us. And so they are the kind of the other part of our Bible study group. So if they're up for Bible study on Thursday, we'll have it. If not, we'll just start next week. I'd like to thank Dave Meyer for helping me with the basement classroom this last week. His help is greatly appreciated. Are there any other announcements that we need to make? Yes.
After 2 years almost, we're going to try to start CWF again the first Monday of April, which is the 4th, at 7 o'clock.
All right. So CWF will meet April the 4th. On a Monday at 7 o'clock. Any others? We still have several people that are on our prayer list. Bill and Pam asked that I add Dave Ott to the prayer list. He is struggling with prostate cancer. And then I got a text from Frida this morning. Don and Frida were planning on coming, but then Don was really struggling with his balance and being dizzy, so he went back to bed, and he is going to be going in for some tests to try and figure out what's going on there. So Frida asked that we keep them in our prayers as well. Are there any others we want to mention this morning? Yes, Chester.
Craig is home from the hospital. His bypass surgery went well, but he's moving real slow.
Awesome. So that's good news. The bypass surgery went well. I imagine he'll move slow for a little while yet. Any others? Yes.
I want to thank you for doing the service for Bev Shatzel. This is coming from the Crosbys. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Any others? If not, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our great and our gracious Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne, we just thank you so much for this day that you have given to us. We thank you for the opportunity to be able to worship you in your house this morning. As we come together, we claim the promise that's in your word that wherever two or three are gathered together in your name, that you are there. And so we ask that as your Holy Spirit moves in your house this morning, that you would change us and make us more like you. I ask, Heavenly Father, that you just be with those that are on our prayer list. Ask, Lord, that you be with Don as he is struggling with dizziness, and that they be able to figure out what's going on there, and whether that be through your hand or whether that be through medication, that they be able to get a handle on that. We ask that you be with Dave Ott, as he is struggling with cancer, and that, Lord, we just pray for victory for him as well, that you would just bring healing to him, whether that be through your hand or the hand of the doctors. We ask, Lord, that you be with those who are struggling in Ukraine. And Lord, we just pray that you would move and that you would bring a resolution to the warfare that's happening there and the loss of life. And Lord, we just pray so desperately for the refugees and for those who have been displaced and for those who have lost loved ones. Lord, it just is an indication of how much our world needs Jesus. We pray that you just be with each and every one that's on our prayer list this morning, and that you just move in a mighty way and bring victory to your people. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 160. And let's stand as we sing the first, the final, second and final verse, 160.
Showers of blessing, this is the promise of God. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, oh that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead.
You may be seated. Our next hymn is hymn number 82. 82, and we'll sing all three verses of Come Thou Fount.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, Mount of God's unchanging love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by Thy help I come, and I hope by Thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed His precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let Thy grace, Lord, like a fetter bind my wandering heart to Thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for Thy courts above.
You know, sometimes as we're singing some of these songs, and there's like old English, like it talks about a fetter in that song, which is a binding, you know, bind my heart. I sometimes wonder, like, how many people, like, have no idea what we're singing about. the song I remember, like, bringing in the sheaves, how many little kids I've heard bringing in the sheets because they just aren't sure what they're talking about there. Our next hymn is hymn number 342, and let's sing the first, second, and fourth verse.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without Him I would fall. When I am sad, to Him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, He makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trial sore. I go the
communion meditation this morning is entitled A Silent Sermon. Communion services usually are very quiet gatherings. The music is usually soft, and people do not talk and laugh among themselves. This is almost universally true regardless of the church tradition of those partaking. While there is an appropriate sense of joy in the celebration of what Jesus has done for us, there is also a silent awe that comes over us because of the magnitude of the sacrifice. Our quietness is almost instinctive. And so it was for a monk, as the old story goes, who was assigned to do the homily for the brothers in his monastery. He had never preached before, and he announced he would be preaching on the love of Christ. The brothers wondered what he could say on that topic that would be original. When it came time for the message, the lights went out. Silently, the monk came to the front of the chapel and proceeded to light a candle. He held the lit candle up to the crucifix on the wall and let the light linger on the wounded feet of Jesus. He then moved the candle slightly so the congregation could see the wounded hands of Jesus. He paused for them to see the wounded side of Jesus. Finally, the candle highlighted the wounded brow of Jesus. Saying nothing, he blew out the candle and dismissed the crowd. Was it really a sermon? The brothers thought so, and so do I. He had led the worshipers to meditate on the wounds of Christ. Something similar happens when we look at and eat the bread, which represents Christ's body, and when we look at and drink the cup that represents his blood. Silently, we look at the bread, and it speaks to us. Silently, we look at the cup, and it speaks to us as well. We could talk long and wax eloquent about the sacrifice of Christ, but it needs no rhetorical flourishes from us. The suffering of Christ speaks to us in the quietness of the moment. That is a sermon worth listening to. Our communion hymn this morning is hymn number 175. Sing verses 1 and 2 and stand on the fourth verse.
Dear precious Heavenly Father, As we silently come before you this morning, Lord, may our hearts truly be open to you, that you will come to us through thy Holy Spirit. We ask thee, dear Lord, to bless this meal, Lord, this great meal that is designed to feed our spiritual bodies. Bless the loaf, dear Lord, which represents your Son's broken body there upon the cross. Bless the cup, which represents the shed blood. And as we partake it, Lord, help us to recommit ourselves to you, Lord, that we truly go out and continue to minister to you and for you in everywhere we go. We just bless these things, dear Lord, in thy precious and holy name. Amen.
Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne, it is our desire to lift you up and to praise you. And Lord, as we reflect on the many blessings that you've bestowed on us, we give back a portion of that that you've so freely given. As we do so, we ask for your continued blessing on both the gift and the giver, and that, Lord, that you would just help us to use those gifts to reach out to our community and to our world with the love of Jesus Christ to all who will listen. I ask now that you be with the remainder of our service. I ask that you be with me as I bring the message, that it be one that's easy to understand and easy to apply. All these things we ask, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. In present times, we have come to understand a disciple to be someone who learns from or about his teacher or leader. While clearly this is part of being a disciple, there is much more to being a disciple than that. In Jesus' day, discipleship wasn't just about learning from the Master, it was about becoming like Him, emulating Him, learning from Him. And so the disciples, when they would learn from their rabbi, their teacher, these disciples or talmidim, or talmid if you're talking about an individual disciple, which is the Greek word for that, they lived with their rabbi. They saw him when he went to bed at night. They saw him when he got up in the morning. They saw how he related to people every single day, not just in a classroom sitting. Ray Vandalon says this about discipleship. The decision to follow a rabbi as a Talmid or disciple meant total commitment in the first century, as it does today. Since the Talmid was totally devoted to becoming like the rabbi, he would have spent his entire time listening and observing the teacher to know how to understand the scripture and how to put it into practice. Jesus describes his relationship to his disciples in exactly this way. In Matthew 10:24-25 and Luke 6:40, he chose them to be with him so that they could be like him. Most students sought out the rabbis they wished to follow. And this happened to Jesus on occasion as well. If a student wanted to study with a rabbi, he would ask if he might follow the rabbi. The rabbi would consider the student's potential to become like him and whether he would make the commitment necessary. It is very likely most students were turned away. Some, of course, were invited to follow me. This indicated that the rabbi believed the potential Talmid or disciple had the ability and the commitment to become like him. It would be a remarkable affirmation of the confidence the teacher had in the student. And, of course, again, that was Ray Vandalon from That the World May Know Ministries, who made this statement. Today, I want to share with you one of the saddest stories recorded in the New Testament. It's a story about a young man who is invited to become one of Jesus' Talmidim, or disciples. But he refused when he felt the price of discipleship was just too high. Turn with me, if you will, to Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. And this morning, I'll be reading from the New Century Version. It says this: as Jesus started to leave, a man ran to him and fell on his knees before Jesus. The man asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to live forever, to have life forever?" Jesus answered, "Why do you call me good? Only God is good. You know the commands. You must not murder anyone. You must not be guilty of adultery. You must not steal. You must not tell lies about your neighbor. You must not cheat. Honor your father and mother." So what is Jesus talking about here specifically? The Ten Commandments, isn't he? The man said, "Teacher, I have obeyed all these things since I was a boy." Jesus, looking at the man, loved him and said, "There's one more thing that you need to do. Go and sell everything that you have and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." He was very sad to hear Jesus say this, and he left sorrowfully because he was rich. I believe that in this particular story, when Jesus looked at him, he saw what was the greatest barrier to him truly being a disciple. And he said, "You have to put me first over this." Today, if Jesus was looking at us, he might not say, go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, he might say, you need to quit your job and come follow me because you're placing your job before me. He might say, if you really want to be my disciple, I need you to move away from your family because you're placing your family before me. I mean, I don't want you to misunderstand. I think sometimes we give the wealth thing this really bad rap, and it can be because it has this desire to make us trust in ourselves rather than trusting in God. But there are other things that get in the way of us pursuing Jesus the way he calls us to pursue him and to love him. In this particular story, it happened to be the man's wealth. It's a sad story because it represents a journey never taken. This young man was excited. The Bible says that he ran to Jesus and he fell to his knees to ask him his question. Yet when the conversation was over, he left in great sorrow because he was unwilling to accept the cost of following Jesus. It is sad because Jesus offered this young man the same opportunity that he offered to Peter, James, John, and the other disciples. But because of his earthly riches, this young man threw it all away. Stop and think about that for just a minute. For a few possessions, he threw away the chance to be with the creator of the universe. To see God literally face to face and learn from him that what was most important. Being a Talmid or a disciple requires complete and unwavering commitment to follow his rabbi. Jesus put it this way in Mark 8:34-37. He says, if any of you wants to be my follower, he told them, you must put aside your selfish ambition, shoulder your cross, and follow me. If you try to keep your life for yourself, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will find true life. And how do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul in the process? Is anything worth more than your soul? To be a disciple means that we must die to ourselves so that we can live for him. This morning I'd like to look at three questions as we seek to define what discipleship really is. So that first question is this: what is discipleship? What is discipleship? It is much more than learning about who Jesus is and what he desires for us. Discipleship is the ability to recognize and follow the Master's leading. Have you ever noticed how a mother can pick out the cry of her child even when surrounded by the noise and cries of other children around her? The disciple is to be like that with his rabbi or master as well. Jesus said it this way in John 10:27. He said, my sheep recognize my voice. I know them and they follow me. I know them and they follow me. In order to do that, we have to both know the Master, which includes studying God's Word, and recognize his voice. And that comes through the leading of the Holy Spirit. But discipleship is more even than that. Discipleship is like the reflection in the mirror this morning. Our goal is to become so like the Master that when we look in the mirror, we see Him instead of ourselves. A true disciple is someone who seeks to become like the rabbi in every aspect of his life. Romans 9:26 puts it this way, "For God knew His people in advance, and He chose them to become like His Son, so that His Son would be the firstborn with many brothers and sisters." So you notice there that the word Son is capitalized. That is a direct reference to Jesus. So when He says there that He chose them to become like His Son, it doesn't mean like one of His children. It means He chose us to be specifically like Jesus, so that His Son, Jesus, would be the firstborn with many brothers and sisters. The New American Standard Version says that God planned for us to be conformed to the image of His Son. So when you conform something, you change its shape so that it becomes the shape of something else. The New American Standard says that it is God's desire for us to conform to the image of Jesus, to become like Jesus. What's unfortunate is that in many of our churches today, we want to learn about Jesus, but we're not so excited about becoming like Jesus. And this morning, this preacher is preaching not just to the congregation, he's preaching to himself. Because being a disciple is not just about learning about Jesus, it's about the relationship with Jesus. It's all about the relationship. When Jesus says, in that day, people will say to me, "But Lord, Lord, didn't I do all these great things in Your name? Didn't I preach in Your name? Didn't I do miracles in Your name?" And He'll say, "Depart from me, for I never what? I never knew You. Not that I didn't know who You are, but we didn't have a relationship. I didn't know You in a relationship. You were just this guy that was out there doing that stuff." That's what discipleship is really about. It's about our relationship with Jesus and becoming like Him. I'm an intellectual guy, right? And so, I tend to have this one track mind, which drives my wife like insane crazy. Because I'll pursue something relentlessly until I either master it or I just become tired of it and move on to something else. And my wife, who is a great multitasker, it just drives her crazy, right? But so, like, if I'm interested in something, I will study about it, and all of the details and the facts. And if I'm going to try and do this project, I want it to be perfect. So I'm going to, study everything about it, all of the different things, and I tend to approach things intellectually. Melanie approaches things much more emotionally, right? And I think that's kind of a tendency of gender, not always, but I think that's kind of a tendency of gender. Guys, a lot of times we'll say, what do you think about this? And women will say, how do you feel about that? Right? Because we are kind of wired differently. And there is this this danger to try to approach discipleship strictly from this, like, you know, mental kind of thing, to learn all there is about Jesus so that I can master all of that, but then we never actually get down to the everyday practice of living it out. You know, we've all probably met people who are like really book smart, but not very wise. Because wisdom is the ability to use your knowledge. When it comes to discipleship, being a disciple of Jesus is not just about what we know, it's about implementing what we know to become like Jesus. It's about the relationship that we have with him. You see, God's plan for his people goes beyond just knowing about him. He wants us to be just like him in every way, to become a reflection of the Master. We need to reflect Jesus in our attitudes, in the way that we think, in the way that we act, and in the way that we relate to others. That the World May Know ministry continues to say this: being like the rabbi is the major focus of a disciple's life. They listen and question. They respond when questioned. They follow without knowing where the rabbi is taking them. Knowing that the rabbi has a good reason for bringing them to the right place for his teaching to make the most sense. This means that the present day disciple must be no less focused on the rabbi. We must be with him in his word. We must follow him even when we're not sure of the final destination. We must live by his teaching, which means that we know what those teachings are. And we must imitate him whenever we can. In other words, everything becomes secondary in the life to being like him. Again, that's from That the World May Know Ministries. The goal of the disciple is to resemble or become so like the master that he's able to say, like the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11:1, follow my example even as I follow the example of Jesus Christ. The second question is this: what are the benefits of becoming a disciple? What are the benefits of becoming a disciple? The second question that we're looking to answer is that. I believe that there's many. First, as I become more like Jesus, I will have a heart like his. In Luke 7, 12 through 14, it says, as he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the town was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her. And he said, don't cry. Then he went up to the man. Then he touched the coffin, and those carrying it stood still. He said, young man, I say to you, get up. The dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. That's an amazing story, isn't it? But the part that I want to bring out is the part that I've underlined this morning. When Jesus saw this lady who is in pain, in anguish, and concerned about her very livelihood, to be honest, today we live in a society that has all of these safety nets for people if things go bad. You know, we have welfare, we have, you know, food stamps, all of these other programs, housing based off of your income, all of this different stuff. In Jesus' day, none of that existed. The dowry that a man paid for his wife, for his bride, that dowry was saved by the bride so that she could take care of herself if her husband passed away unexpectedly. When Jesus tells the story about the lost coin was part of that woman's dowry. And many times they would take that dowry, that money, and they would make it into jewelry or other different things, but it was really her insurance policy in case something happened to her husband so that she could somehow survive. And so if something happened, you know, to your husband, you look to your children to help take care of you if you couldn't take care of yourself. Here's this widow lady who's lost her husband. Now she's lost her only son. And can you imagine the anguish that she is going through? And Jesus, when he sees her, his heart went out to her. And so he gave her back her son. We should have a heart like Jesus. As I become more like him, I will have a heart like his. As the image in the mirror becomes more and more Christ-like, I'll begin to feel the way that he feels. Jesus was a man of great compassion. He was a champion of the helpless and a defender of the downtrodden. So much so that on more than one occasion, Jesus was accused of being a friend of sinners. Jesus' response was that it's not the healthy that need a doctor, but the sick. As I learn from the rabbi and become more like him, the things that are important to him are the things that will be important to me as well. As we become more like Jesus, the same thing will happen to us. And the thing that is most important to Jesus is the eternal souls of people. It was so important to God that he sent his only son into creation to die for mankind's sin. Second, I will see as he sees. In Matthew 9:36, it says, when he saw the crowds, he felt sorry for them because they were hurting and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. As I become more like Jesus, I will see as he sees. Jesus looked not on the outward appearances, but what was on the inside. Too many times we see people who are overweight or bald or have bad eyes, who are dressed poorly or maybe are smelly. Or maybe, you know, we see this person that we think is arrogant, but if we saw on the inside, we'd see that his arrogance is bluster to cover up the insecurity that he feels inside. You know, we need to see the way that Jesus sees. As we become more like Jesus and are conformed to his image, we'll begin to see the way Jesus does too. Thirdly, I can look to the future with hope and expectation. 1 Peter 3:11-13 says, you ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness. You know, this passage of scripture is one that maybe when you think about it, makes you pause for just a second. Because it says there, we ought to live holy and godly lives as we look forward to the what? The day of God. Do you know what that is? That's the day when the Lord returns. You know, it's going to be a good day for God's people, but it's going to be a very bad day for everybody else. You know, we were looking in the book of Revelation. We're starting to look at that in our prophecy Bible study, and there's a lot of bad stuff that happens there. When you look at the bowls of the seven trumpet judgments and the bowls of God's wrath and those things that are happening as the day of the Lord is approaching, man, that's not some cool stuff there. Right? The four men of the apocalypse there, you know, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, you know, war and death and famine and, you know, all of that stuff is like, whoa, dude. But, you know, here is Peter that's saying we need to look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. And in keeping with his promise, we're looking forward to the new heaven and the new earth. In order to get to the new heaven and the new earth, what happens to what has to happen to the old heaven and the old earth? It's got to be destroyed, right? By fire. As we become more like him, we can look forward to the future with hope and expectation. And that's something that as we have been looking in the last couple of years, that's hard to do. And the only way you can do that is if you have your eyes focused on Jesus and remember that he is ultimately in control, not this world. Fourth, I can experience real peace and trust. John 14:27, I am leaving you with the gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace that I give isn't like the peace that the world gives. So don't be troubled or afraid. I can become more like, as I become more like Jesus, I can experience real peace and trust. Just as the disciple of Bible times trusted his rabbi and master, so I can trust Jesus, knowing that even in all of the chaos that is around me, that Jesus is still in control. Remember, 1 Corinthians 15 says that Christ must reign until all of his enemies have been defeated. And the last enemy to be defeated is what?
Death.
Do people still die? Then Christ is still reigning. He's still in control. And then finally, I can draw others to Jesus. Jesus said in John 12:32, if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people toward me. If we are reflecting Jesus in the mirror of our life and people are seeing Christ through us, Jesus will draw all people to himself. Jesus instructed us to let our light shine so that when men see our good works, that their attention is pointed toward heaven. All of these are benefits that I can experience as the image in the mirror becomes more like Jesus. As I become more like Jesus as his disciple. The third question is this. What are we looking to answer is, what are some of the obstacles to becoming a disciple? What are some of the obstacles to becoming a disciple? What is it that gets in the way of us becoming a faithful Talmid or disciple? First, and of course we saw that in the passage of scripture that we first read, sometimes we place ourselves or our possessions first. In verse 21 and 22 there, it says this, Jesus, looking at the man, loved him and said, there's one more thing you need to do. Go and sell everything that you have and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Excuse me. And then come follow me. The man was very sad to hear Jesus say this. And he left sorrowfully because he was wealthy. We saw one obstacle earlier in this message, where the rich young ruler couldn't put Jesus ahead of his wealth. The Bible says that he went away very sad because he could not give up his wealth to follow Jesus. One of the obstacles that prevent us from being Jesus' disciple and reflecting him in the mirror of our lives is that our inability to give up our possessions or the things standing between us and Jesus. Someone far wiser than me has coined this statement. He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. I've always loved that statement. He is no fool who gives up that which he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Everything that surrounds you is temporary. The Bible says that this whole world will one day be consumed by fire. We come into this world with nothing, and we can take nothing with us when we die. Since that is true, what possessions do you have that are worth standing between you and Jesus? A second thing that gets in the way of us being a disciple is that we want to learn about him, but not become like him. In Matthew 15, 8 and 9, it says, "These people show honor to me with their words, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is worthless. The things they teach are nothing but human rules." When Jesus said that in Matthew 15, 8 and 9, he actually was quoting scripture, and the scripture that he quoted was Isaiah 29, 13. A second obstacle to being a disciple is that we want to learn about him. We just don't want to become like him. The scripture Jesus quoted to you was being addressed to the religious leaders of Jesus' day. And that, as I said before, the passage actually comes from Isaiah 29, 13, which says this: "The Lord says, these people say they love me, they show honor to me with their words, but their hearts are far from me. The honor that they show me is nothing but human rules." You see, God doesn't just want our lip service. He wants us to live for him as well. When your kids were little, did you ever ask them to do something and they said, "Yep, I'll get right on it here in a little bit"? And then a little bit goes by, and then more time goes by, and nothing happens. Yeah, I'm the only one, right? I'm the only one that that's ever happened to. I doubt it. Okay? And it's frustrating, isn't it? Because when we asked, we were looking to have it done, not like 7 days later. It's the same way with God and Jesus. You know, he said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and then not do the things that I tell you to do?" You see, the Pharisees knew all about God, but they didn't know God. They knew the Torah frontwards and backwards. They knew all sorts of facts about God, but they didn't really know God. Some of the most scathing condemnation from Jesus was directed at the religious leaders of his day because they were convinced that they had it all together, but were actually leading people not toward God, but away from him. The problem is that today, most of Jesus' followers lack the passion of a disciple. We think of discipleship as learning theological knowledge rather than devoting our lives to the rabbi. All too often, people miss opportunities to experience God's power. We're just too busy with our own schedules and goals, or we're too afraid to leave our security behind. We spend lots of time and energy to know about Jesus, but we never get around to becoming like Jesus. Jesus is calling us to not simply know about him, but to become like him. Thirdly, a third obstacle is that we don't make Jesus Lord. We don't make Jesus Lord. Luke 6, 46 says, "So why do you call me Lord when you won't obey me?" One final obstacle that we have to being a disciple is that we never get around to making Jesus Lord. We understand that we're sinners and that we need a Savior. We know beyond any shadow of a doubt that we need forgiveness of our sins. But to make Jesus Lord, to be willing to say to Jesus as the disciple would, Master, here's my life, use it and make it whatever you will. That's true discipleship. It means that I must die to myself if I'm going to live for him. Perhaps part of the problem is that we don't really trust Jesus with the steering wheel of our life. We used to say reins of our life, but nobody rides a horse anymore, right? So we don't really trust him with the steering wheel of our life. Sure, we will follow, but only as long as Jesus is going in the same direction that we want to go. But to be a disciple is to trust Jesus completely, knowing that he loves you and only wants what is very best for you. As we look at Jesus' disciples, we're challenged to radical discipleship. Following the rabbi wherever he leads, no matter how scared we may feel, no matter what he asks us to leave behind, Jesus truly believes his disciples can become like him, both in the mirror and in our lives, even when we feel tired, fallen, or incapable. The first 12 disciples were ordinary people, but with God's power, they transformed the world. Our world still needs transformation, maybe more now than it ever has. It is filled with superficiality and selfishness, and people yearn for something real. They aren't impressed by hypocrites, but rather take notice when someone puts everything on the line for their God. If Christians are willing to demonstrate radical discipleship, the people around us may just want to meet our rabbi or teacher for themselves. Today, Jesus calls you to be his Talmudim. We must know God's word and Jesus' interpretation of it. We must be passionate in our devotion to that word and Jesus' example. As we're filled with the Spirit, we must be obsessed with being like him as far as is humanly possible, so that his image is reflected in the mirror of our life. We must strive for relationships with others so that they will observe us and seek to imitate our love, devotion to God, and our Jesus-like lifestyle. Today, you've come to a crossroad. Because you've been confronted with God's word, it's impossible to leave as you came this morning. The decision is before you, and you must choose. Will you embrace the decision to follow Jesus and be filled with joy and excitement as you contemplate the journey? Or will you leave as the rich young ruler with great sorrow because the cost is simply too great? What is standing in the way between you and Jesus? Is it your possessions like the rich young ruler? Is it your family or friends? Is it your own selfish ambitions and desires? Remember, Jesus says, what good is it for you to gain the whole world and yet forfeit your soul? Will you allow someone or something to cause you to throw away the greatest opportunity of your life like the rich young ruler did? We talk about our goal being able to go to heaven, but what makes heaven, heaven? Is it the gates of pearl, the walls of jasper, the streets of gold? No. Heaven is where God is. In the back of our mind, we can't wait to get to heaven so that we can meet God or Jesus. But God's plan isn't for you to know and experience him. God's plan, rather, is for you to know and experience him right now. Maybe that's why we don't long for heaven like we should, because we're going to meet a stranger instead of a dear friend. Jesus is calling you to be his Talmudim or disciple. He's calling you to know him and to become like him. so that when people see you, they see Christ reflected in you, that you become the mirror in which people see Jesus. Jesus said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me." But that can only happen if people see Jesus in the mirror of your life. If they see Jesus reflected in you. This morning, we offer you the opportunity to accept Jesus' invitation to be his disciple. Will you come follow him? Our invitation hymn this morning is hymn number 361. And let's stand as we sing the first and final verse. 361.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give thee rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save.
Father God, as we come before your throne, I just thank you again for your love and for your grace and for your mercy. I thank you that you loved us enough to come into this world to show us how to live and ultimately to die on the cross to pay the price for our sins. Lord, the message this morning was not designed to make anybody feel guilty, but Heavenly Father, to remind us that you call us to become like you. Watch over us now, direct us, and keep us. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Our God reigns.